it's great to be here. So our class two speaker still treasures the 1930s era microscope she bought with her babysitting money when she was 13 years old. And she can vividly recall the first time she watched a paramecium feed itself. Now there's a mother's love. Her curiosity about tiny living things has never waned. Her research has produced new understanding of the rich diversity of microbial communities called microbiomes and the effect they have on human health and soil environments. She pioneered the use of metagenomics, a new way of studying microorganisms. Rather than culture them in a petri dish, it is now possible to extract DNA directly from an environmental sample, like seawater, soil, or the human gut for analysis. This technique opens doors to addressing complex challenges in medicine, agriculture, and environmental stewardship. She is widely recognized for her contributions to science education and diversity, receiving the Presidential Award for Science Mentoring, among many other honors. Her seminal study of gender bias found that the gender of a name on a science resume affected a professor's inclination to hire, mentor, and pay applicants for a lab position, even among female professors. For this work in 2012, Nature magazine named her one of 10 people who mattered this year. She was also appointed by President Barack Obama and confirmed by the United States Senate to serve as the Associate Director for Science at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. During her 3 years in that role, she spearheaded initiatives on precision medicine, soil health, forensic science, and the image of women and STEM careers in the media. So please welcome Howard Hughes Medical Institute Professor, Director of the Wisconsin Institute for Discovery, and Vilas Research Professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Jo Handelsman.
Thank you, Geri, and thank you all for the great honor to be here today and to address this august body. It's really a very special privilege to represent the biological sciences, but I'm going to do it in a very personal way. I'd like to start by telling you a little bit about the 3 years I spent with President Obama in his administration. I was one of his science advisors, and I advised him on issues as diverse, as Geri mentioned, as precision medicine, gene editing, forensic science, Ebola virus, and STEM education. Some of the topics were his choosing, some were mine, and some were rapid responses to emerging world problems. In those very exciting and heady 3 years, I wrote many memos to the president to inform him about issues that were close to my heart and many that needed to be closer to the nation's heart. One of my great regrets about my time in the White House was that I was unable to get a memo to the president on what I thought was probably the most pressing issue of our time, the loss of our soil. I wrote a memo, but was never able to penetrate the phalanx surrounding the president with this particular one. It was blocked at every turn. So I vowed to make the subject of that memo the top priority of the rest of my career as a scientist. And in that capacity, I'd like to read to you now the memo that I might have sent to President Obama. Dear Mr. President, I write to alert you to the soil crisis that threatens soil across the United States and many other regions of the world. Soil is a precious resource that underpins the health of the earth and its civilizations. Yes, we're talking about soil. We call it soil, we call it earth. Sometimes I've heard you call it dirt, very disrespectfully. In Spanish, we call it suelo, adam in Hebrew, talaj in Hungarian, udango in Swahili, and dojo in Japanese. But whatever we call it, it's the product of millennia of biological and physical forces that act on the Earth's crust. Pulverized geologic material is weathered and mixes with dead and live plant, animal, and microbial materials, and the chemicals released by their decomposition. These are the starting materials of soil. Then water percolates through, air fills its empty pockets, plants penetrate, animals burrow, and microbes turn the crank of nutrient cycles. Over hundreds of years, soil is enriched and deepened by these processes to produce the fertile material we know as topsoil on Earth today. Soil supports many essential processes. Of course, familiar to most people is its role in agriculture and forestry, where soil forms the substrate in which plants grow. But soil's profound impact on the Earth extends far beyond plant growth. All organisms depend on soil for clean water. In fact, soil serves as the largest filter for water on Earth. Soil microorganisms manage the nitrogen, phosphorus, and water cycles, and soil serves as the largest repository for carbon on Earth. It contains three times the amount of carbon in all plants combined, and twice the amount of carbon in the atmosphere. Practical uses of soil abound, constructing buildings, roadbeds, pottery, and it's also the source of drugs used in traditional and modern medicine, including 3/4 of the antibiotics used in clinical medicine today. It contains the most biologically diverse environment on Earth, gifting us with the great potential of great discovery and great beauty. Now soil is under threat. It is being eroded and degraded rapidly. And those processes are likely to accelerate with the projected climate changes that produce more frequent heavy precipitation events. The United States and many other countries are eroding soil at 10 to 100 times the rate at which it is produced. By some of the projections by my staff in the White House, the United States will run out of soil on much of its sloped agricultural land by the end of the 21st century. For those of you still living in the 19th century, that's this century. But many regions will be barren of soil in 10 to 20 years, although the exact endpoint is unclear, and it is still abundantly clear that the current trend is not sustainable. If it continues, we will run out of soil. The endpoint will vary across the landscape depending upon the slope of the land, weather events, and farming practices. The Midwest has already lost 1/2 of its soil since 1850, and almost 25% of Iowa has already lost all of its topsoil. With these trends, food production will confront unprecedented challenges as erosion intensifies. There's a long history of civilizations collapsing because of soil erosion. The population, for example, of Easter Island declined from 14,000 to 2,000 after their soil eroded from steep mountainsides into the ocean, leaving their island without a source of agricultural production. Similar examples of societies that have overtilled their soil, which then eroded along with their ability to produce food, abound in regions of China, Africa, and the United States. The good news is that sufficient knowledge is in hand to diminish or even halt soil erosion with relatively little short-term cost and substantial long-term gains and savings. Agricultural practices such as no-till planting, use of cover crops, and interplanting crops such as corn with deep-rooted prairie plants, the very plants that created our Midwestern soil in the first place, comprise the trilogy of proven methods to prevent erosion and rebuild soil health. These farming practices would enhance soil carbon storage, thereby reducing greenhouse gases. In fact, in the Paris climate talks of 2016, there was a proposal to increase soil carbon worldwide by 0.4%, which would be sufficient to compensate for the projected increased carbon emissions, thereby keeping atmospheric carbon at its current levels. But the United States failed to sign on with that accord. There are several policies that your administration could implement that would encourage farmers to adopt soil protective practices and build up soil carbon. The administration could galvanize consumers to participate in a movement toward a soil-safe label for food that would be based on certification of farming practices that build rather than destroy soil. The administration could partner with farmers, environmental groups, agrochemical companies, food retailers, and consumers to develop criteria for certification and then guide its implementation in a manner that makes changes for farming practices financially feasible for the farmers who practice them. Mr. President, I deliver to you a challenging problem, but one that can be quickly solved. In 1 year, we could halt soil erosion. All we need is the will, and we dare not lack that will, or our civilization as we know it will not be sustained.